feature presentation.
Welcome back to another untitled movie or streaming review. I'm one of your hosts, Matt Rohrbeck, alongside, he's allergic to tomatoes, but he is tomato meter approved, Eric Marchin.
Happy Hawkeye, bro.
Happy Hawkeye to you as well, my friend. It is the holidays. I have my little very depressing Charlie Brown tree behind me and all my clutter still. Eric, are you in the holiday spirit yet or no?
Are you
a big Christmas guy? I don't know if we talked about this.
I'm sure we have on the show. Right? Well, I enjoy what it brings out in people in terms of goodwill and, you know, spending time with family and those kind of things and what have you, whether it be Christmas or Hanukkah or Kwanzaa or whatever you celebrate. Like those aspects of it are nice, but I think it was ruined for me in terms of some of the more festive aspects or the commercial aspects because of working at Toys R Us in high school and having to listen to the same 10 Christmas songs for an 8-hour shift and see grown adults break down and cry asking for robo dogs that they
Turbo Man
that we had in the back that we were holding for elite customers. So you know, that kind of sullies it a little bit, but I also feel that we've already let down the people watching this because we did not wear coordinated tracksuits.
Yes, bro, we did not wear tracksuits, bro. Today we are reviewing the first two episodes of the new Hawkeye series from Marvel Studios on Disney Plus, which is premiering this Wednesday, the first two episodes. If you guys haven't listened or watched one of our kind of streaming reviews, when we're not reviewing the whole series, like all six episodes or the entire season or something like that, we're kind of just giving you our first thoughts on those couple episodes, and we're not necessarily going to put a score on it or a star rating or anything like that. We're just going to kind of give you an idea of what to expect and what we felt about the first couple episodes and if we're kind of intrigued by the series or if it's kind of fumbling. So I'm excited to talk about this. It's take two. Eric and I started talking about it. And then we're like, maybe let's not mention that.
Well, now let's be specific here. It was me who mentioned something specific that happens within the first 15 minutes of episode one that might not necessarily be a spoiler in terms of narrative because it's revealed so early, but for people that are watching it that
are big
MCU fans
it may be
a spoiler. And this is coming from somebody that does like the MCU and has watched all the movies and shows and things like that, but again, when it comes to spoilers, it's one of those things where I think you could almost look at a lot of stuff in an episode or two episodes or within the context of a Marvel movie, even now, it's like, what is spoiler and what's not spoiler?
I agree. I would say if you don't want anything spoiled, just wait until Wednesday and then watch those first two episodes and come back and listen to us. We are not really going to spoil anything, hence doing a second recording after, you know, 5-10 minutes, because we don't want to spoil anything for you, because personally, that opening, which we'll kind of go into and the rest, was very surprising to me, and I liked that because I was like, oh shit, this is how it's gonna start. That's kind of cool. But we'll get into that. It stars Jeremy Renner as the titular Hawkeye, coming back, finally getting his due. Eric, finally getting his due.
It's his time to shine, Matt.
And
after that,
also
app, right?
Yeah, God. And also introducing Hailee Steinfeld as Kate Bishop, who it looks like will take over the Hawkeye mantle moving forward, but maybe Jeremy Renner will also stick around. We don't know. Also starring Vera Farmiga, Fra Fee, Tony Dalton, Brian D'Arcy James, Alakwa Cox. Am I pronouncing that right, Eric? I think so.
Yes.
And more. Let's get into it. Eric, do you want me to take it away?
I think you're going to take this one because, one, you are a big MCU fan, but also you know sort of where the adaptation is coming from,
where
it's sort of mining from in terms of the source material.
Yeah, the source material is based off of the Matt Fraction and David Aja comic run from the mid-2010s. I recently just read it because, again, I'm not a big Hawkeye guy, I guess, a Hawk guy. But
Ethan Hawke.
Yeah, sure. I would say, like, in the Avengers, I've always thought Jeremy Renner has been totally fine. I've had nothing against him and nothing really like, oh man, Hawkeye's been awesome. And even when it comes to comic books, when I got back into them, you know, 10, 15 years ago, Hawkeye's not like the one where I'm like, ooh, gotta read a good Hawkeye comic. And I think that was kind of what was happening in Marvel as well, because I feel like this Hawkeye comic run by Matt Fraction and David Aja is something that kind of launched it going, holy shit, everyone needs to read this. And everyone's like, read a Hawkeye comic? And then it's actually fantastic. I read it this past summer when I was at the cottage, fell in love with it, fell in love with the Kate Bishop character. And then I did it because I knew this series was coming up. So, and I don't regret it at all. So if you're interested, I would say read it before. You can tell that they're changing certain things up to make it fit into the MCU mold. But basically what we have here is it picks up at the after the events of Endgame. Jeremy Renner is kind of, or Hawkeye is in New York City with his kids, on a little vacation with them, trying to spend time with them as, you know, he, after 5 years of thinking that they were all gone and becoming Ronin, he is back to his kind of regular life. It doesn't seem like he's necessarily still part of the Avengers or whatever's going on at this time period, but he's just kind of in New York with his kids, going to see Rogers the Musical.
Well, Christmas in New York specifically.
Yeah, Christmas
too.
In New York. Yeah. So it's a couple days before the holidays, so he's spending some time with his kids. The wife is back home, Linda Cardellini. And it's just kind of, it starts off, I like that they kind of show that in the comics, it's a big part that he has a hearing aid. And it's just kind of Hawkeye.
And he's also starting to use sign as well, American Sign Language. So you get the idea that he is starting to go deaf.
Mm-hmm. And then on the other side of things, we're introduced to Kate Bishop, who is a self-proclaimed master archer. And there is a connection there of why she is obsessed with Hawkeye, which we kind of alluded to, that I think is really great. And I hope no one spoils it for you guys. But it picks up, she's 22. She comes from a wealthy background. Her mother's played by Vera Farmiga. And essentially, she gets kind of intertwined into a criminal organization that she ends up being in possession of the Ronin costume and wears it to try to help take these guys down, and crosses paths with our Hawkeye, Jeremy Renner, and is being chased by the tracksuit mafia.
Bro.
Yeah, bro. That's a bro a lot. I'm not as good as Eric when it comes to synopses, but
I thought that was kinda great.
That's like top level. I don't want to go too into it either of like exactly, you know, how they cross paths or why she kind of has this obsession with Hawkeye, like I mentioned, I think is really cool.
She's the only one.
But Hawkeye also has a history with this tracksuit mafia, and then they kind of have to work together to, you know, Hawkeye's trying to get the Ronin costume back, and then kind of chaos ensues. So Eric, what were your thoughts on, these first two episodes? I'll kick it over to you.
Yeah. I mean, I liked it. I didn't love it per se, but I think the second episode kind of gives you the gist of what the show is going to be moving forward, where you have this dynamic between somebody who's kind of, you know, more grizzled and, you know, kind of just going through the motions of kind of cleaning up a mess, and then kind of the young novice who comes in and is excited and eager to kind of like, you know, kick butt and save the day. And so, you know, it's a very kind of cliched but very likable sort of trope within that genre. I mean, it's worked so much within, you know, the buddy cop sort of subgenre with, you know, Shane Black movies specifically, or even like 48 Hours. But I think the big takeaway here is that Hailee Steinfeld is going to be a, you know, massive part of this, not only this series moving forward, but also the MCU. I think she really brings a lot to the table in both of her, you know, dynamic as a character, but also in the performance that she is giving as Kate Bishop. And I think the other thing that I was kind of really fascinated by is how this Ronin suit adds a certain context to what it means to wear the suit now, and sort of what it kind of insinuates when you put this sort of costume on that represents, you know, death and destruction, and you know, there's it's the opposite of what the Avengers were, and obviously the darker side of what Hawkeye was at a certain point in his life, you know, in that 5-year period. So I kind of like that this suit specifically has ramifications, and it becomes almost weirdly like the third wheel to these two characters in a way, and sort of where it goes with you know, that. And I think that's kind of interesting. Overall, I think it's fine. I think it's well made. It's enjoyable. Steinfeld is really exceptional, and I'm looking forward to seeing more of her. And I even really like Jeremy Renner playing again a kind of burnt out, grizzled version of Hawkeye who is finally kind of succumbing to some of his injuries a little bit, or like, you know, like his body's kind of like catching up with him, in the way that we've seen it even with something like in Logan, or one of your favorite series, the Fallen series with Gerard Butler in Angel Has Fallen, when we see that, like, you know, the wear and tear over the years have kind of caught up with him.
And I think Dark Knight Rises as well, and things like that, even though it wasn't as maybe earned in that, because it kind of just jumps there. But yeah, I'm kind of with you where really enjoyed the first two episodes. I think it's hard to talk about what we think of a series when we've seen one third of it. We've seen the first act. But where it leaves off, I'm definitely intrigued. I think standouts for me, I totally agree that Hailee Steinfeld absolutely crushes it. I love the Kate Bishop character, and I can't wait to see, you know, not even just where this series goes, but where she goes in the MCU. I think she's absolutely fantastic. The back and forth between her and Jeremy Renner is great. I think they have great chemistry. I like what you're saying, where he's kind of the broken down, like, I don't want to fucking do this anymore kind of thing, and she's the one being like, you know, I idolize this guy. I get to work with him now. I get to show him that I've, like, you know, I've mirrored my whole life off of, you know, him. And I think that element, I think, is really funny too. And Hawkeye being, you know, the Avenger, kind of like the Aquaman, at least has superpowers, but, like, you know, everyone would make fun of Aquaman in, you know, the Justice League,
or on the Marvel side, right?
But even on the Avenger side, everyone, even in the movies, and it's just like, oh, well, Hawkeye and Black Widow are just humans, right? Like, and I think what's interesting in this series, and is, you know, I think Hawkeye being everyone's, you know, quote unquote least favorite Avenger or something like that, right? And I'm sure there are Hawkeye fans out there, but I was mostly indifferent. And you would go, well, it is kind of ridiculous when this guy's fighting aliens and doing all this when everyone else is superpowered or has a mech suit or you know, armor or things like that. What I think the series does a really good job so far is, like, that human element of superheroes and the Avengers in the MCU universe, like, I think is really kind of cool, and cool for that character. Like, you get to see him on ground level interact with the, you know, humans of New York, and see how much people kind of do idolize him, because I feel like they don't. But, like, for me, it was that part of people, like, appreciating him, of being like, well, they can connect with him on a human level. Cause I feel like, you know, he is the one Avenger that people might see on the streets, right? Like, no one's just going to bump into Thor or Doctor Strange or whoever who has these, they're almost like these incredible, you know, people that you'll never see, right? Like, because they're just this massive presence or celebrity,
or they're whatever. Just, they'll never leave their lab. Or
something like that. I guess, but even then, Bruce, you can't connect on necessarily a superhuman. Sorry, that's a weird double
an everyman thing, kind of way, right?
Yeah, and that's what I liked, like, when he's going out for dinner and people say, oh, thank you, we'll pay for it, or, like, people want his autograph or a photo, and sometimes you can see how he deals with that, of being like, he doesn't want the fame, or he doesn't want to deal with that kind of thing, which I think is interesting. But then you also get that kind of, that people do appreciate him for, you know, doing all this for them and being, you know, just like them. He's a human, he's putting himself out there, he's very good at his craft, but he is just like everyone else he meets on the street. So I think this series does, like, a really kind of cool job of him connecting to people on a human level and then showing their appreciation for Hawkeye. And I think that juxtaposition with how Kate Bishop feels about, you know, Clint, and it's just this, you know, when you meet your heroes and kind of how that, you know, is going to go about. And I like that they're kind of slowly progressing that relationship of just this, you know, just friendship. And I think it's really great. They play off each other really well. I think the action at times can feel a little clunky. It doesn't feel as kind of kinetic as maybe I want it, but then I kind of like that when Kate's fighting, that that's kind of how it is. And she's still kind of, even though she's very good at what she does as well, she's still kind of a rookie when it comes to all this stuff. There are a few standout moments, again, that opening, 10, 15 minutes of the series that I did not expect to open that way. And I thought, like, you know, from the minute, like, hardcore MCU fans, like, the minute the opening happens, you're going to go, okay. And then, like, I really love the opening sequence. I don't think the young actress in the opening sequence was very good, and that kind of took me out of it a little bit. And kid actors can be, like, you know, sort of hit or miss. And I don't think that whole opening completely works, but what it's showing, I think, is really, really cool. Or how it sets up the series, I think, is really, really cool.
There's also some choice haircuts in that scene that I was like, sure, I don't know if that works either.
Yeah, some of the stuff there doesn't completely work, but I like,
but it's to overemphasize, yeah, certain things, right?
And I like the idea of that whole sequence and why, you know, she would be obsessed or would idolize Hawkeye. I think it was a great setup for why that character models her whole life after this guy. I think it's really, really cool. And I think, like, hardcore MCU fans will really kind of go, oh shit, that's really awesome. It's in the trailer, so it's not necessarily a spoiler, but the Rogers the Musical stuff, I think, is really, really funny and really great.
Especially with its historical inaccuracies.
Yeah, and it's just, like, that kind of stuff. I've been watching a lot of musical stuff lately. With, like, Nevis watched Chicago last night, and
we watched Tick, Tick, Boom.
We watched Tick, Tick, Boom, which you guys can check out a review out for, and Encanto, and, you know, tons of musical stuff lately, but... I just thought that was really, really well done, and just the play on that. And I think, again, nerdy MCU people will just have a blast with that sequence. And then, yeah, so I really enjoyed it. And then seeing the moments from the comic, like seeing Lucky the pizza dog. I love that guy. And then
so that's what that dog's name is, because they don't.
Lucky the pizza dog. Sorry, yeah. So anyways,
they don't give him a name to begin with. Did you say he's a
pizza dog? Yeah, or pizza dog. Yeah, I don't know if they'll probably call him Lucky the pizza dog, but
not to be confused with pizza cats.
Yeah, samurai pizza cats. I loved the set design of it. A lot of it's straight out of the comics. So, like, the tracksuit mafia and them saying bro all the time is great. I think them being, like, sort of faceless goons so far, it doesn't necessarily work until we kind of sort of see where things are going in the second episode. I love the design of Kate's apartment. We don't spend enough time there, but right, like, if you've read the comics, like, right when they go in there, they're like, oh man, they nailed that. That's really awesome. And then there's some sequences that just don't really work. I think it's best when, you know, Kate and Clint are together. I think when they're separated, it doesn't. I love the Kate stuff, but I don't necessarily love the Clint stuff by himself.
I don't mind Clint being a dad, and I like that. Like, I agree. I don't necessarily disagree with you either, where, like, I think, you know, Kate's more interesting to kind of follow, but I like the payoff of when Clint is with Kate and being, sure, a dad to her.
Yeah.
You know,
I agree.
And there is that together, surrogate, right, dad thing where, like, I think one of the best moments in episode two, and I don't think that this is spoiler, is just when they're basically, like, he's helping her clean her wounds. And, like, yeah, that's something in this series we really haven't seen in any real capacity, where, like, you actually need to take care of a cut, you know, from getting infected. And I think that, like, that,
I think that goes back to the human thing, right, exactly, that we're talking, yeah, about. Like, this isn't necessarily about a superhero. These people are humans trying to do superhuman things at times. And going back to that, of the human element, like, the series, it's refreshing to have a MCU thing that feels a little bit more human or grounded, right? Like, in the sense where it's not like, there's jokes about an Avengers level threat that we've seen in teasers and trailers and stuff like that, but I think that's just Kate's humor, where it's really just a street level threat, right? Like, it is just streets of New York, you know, what mafia kind of stuff. Like, it's not necessarily a big superhero thing, and then that's kind of refreshing. And I think that's what's kind of cool about this whole series, that it just kind of takes it back down to earth. And I think that's really, really great. And then what I meant by my point about Clint, there's one sequence at like a LARPing kind of thing that I just felt just did not work at all. And they spend like a lot of time on it, it feels like. And it's like this whole kind of B plot, you know, as they have to separate. And I didn't love it. And I just feel like whatever they were trying to do, I just don't think works in that sequence at all.
Yeah, leave that to Sean William Scott and Paul Rudd and role models. Sure. And even the way that he figures out where to go, I think, is a little bit clumsy. Convenient. In terms of its story structure and sort of how he becomes kind of a detective in one moment. It just feels a little bit unearned and to your point, convenient. But I think it's like what I do like is what you already mentioned, is that it is this sort of modest version of an MCU story where both Clint and Kate are basically like a cleanup crew, you know, like they're the two that are kind of dealing with something that is, you know, to anybody else would be a major threat. But considering what Clint has gone through, is just something where it's like, okay, now I have to kind of deal with my own, you know, bag of issues and also kind of clean up the mess that I started 5 years
previously when
I was Ronin. And, you know, this is basically caught up with me the same way that my body is starting to catch up with me. So I think that is interesting as well. And sort of how he is just basically going through the motions of trying to, you know, set things right with his own family. And then on top of that, sort of, you know, get all of his, you know, work related issues sort of sorted. And I think that stuff is interesting. And then again, like, you know, we'll probably see more of this mentorship kind of happen. And I like the kind of reluctancy that he has towards, you know, taking Kate under his wing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, only two episodes in, I feel like it's barely gotten started, even though we've seen, you know, a third of this series. So I'm definitely intrigued at where they leave it. I definitely enjoyed the first two episodes. Things we didn't touch on, like, I think Vera Farmiga is always great.
I'm a little frustrated with her character, though, because there are things where she's having conversations with Hailee Steinfeld, and, you know, Steinfeld's character is making really good points, and
her mom just doesn't want to.
She just doesn't listen. Like, she's not even like being the owner of a security company. Like, even if you don't maybe necessarily believe what your kid is saying, it's like maybe it's good to investigate some of those things and look into that. Another person that I kind of liked popping up, and he doesn't do a lot of work because he's more of a theater guy, was Simon Kalo, who is kind of this patriarch that Steinfeld runs to at a charity event. And he probably is best known to a lot of kids or people our age that grew up watching Ace Ventura: When Nature Calls. He was the villain in that.
There we go. I couldn't put it where he came from. That's really funny.
Good. He's the one that, like, when Ace first arrives in to his like country club, and he sees like the stuff on his shoe and all that, and like he was also in Four Weddings and a Funeral, but he's not one of those actors that like, you know who he is, but he's not in a lot. And he also, I mean, everybody makes the joke that it's like Simon Callow from, you know, American Idol, but they. Different spelling.
Sure. I liked his name too, right?
And what his monogram.
Werther's Original.
The ultimate evil Werther's. Candy.
Tony Dalton, who I really like on Better Call Saul. He's fantastic on that show. I've liked him in the first couple episodes here. And, you know.
Sweet mustache.
Great mustache. But yeah, even in these first two episodes, like, they don't necessarily set up who the big bad is or anything other than the tracksuit mafia, which is, I'm assuming we'll get, you know, bigger reveals and things in episode three. And I'm curious, I'd love to talk about like where we think it's going to go. And, I would love to see like the way that they set this up too. There's like an underground kind of, criminal auction of like black market auction in the show. And I'm like, in the comics, I don't know if I'm talking about things that happen in the comics thing that I could happen, but would the MCU do it? Would that be considered spoiler maybe?
Possibly because it could still happen within
there's a character adaptation. There's a character in the comics who is behind that that I would be really intrigued by if they reintroduce in this series, but I
think
know
I know who
they,
you're talking about,
but I don't know if they will, but I think they could. Yes. And I would love that. But that's kind of almost where I see this going. But then there's other things that I'm very intrigued to see how they change things up from the comic, or how they kind of make it MCU, and what other surprises we get. But
and you're clearly referring to Morph.
Yeah. Morph's coming back, baby. Anyways, I think any final thoughts, Eric? Just
I'm intrigued,
but yeah.
Yeah, again, I think it's one of those shows that maybe hasn't hit the bullseye as of yet, but is kind of circling in that kind of area where it's like it's appealing to people that maybe don't love the fantastical elements of the MCU that we've been getting a lot more lately, with even, you know, the films with Eternals and with the shows as well with Loki. So if you're looking for something a little bit more low key, this is probably something you want to go with. Like, I actually didn't like Black Widow's not great, but I kind of appreciated that it was kind of grounded in kind of the espionage spy genre. This feels even more, as you mentioned, street level.
Yeah.
So and I think that, like, you know, for all the world domination and multiverse stuff that we've gotten, something small and festive like this.
Yeah, we didn't touch on that either. I like the holiday stuff.
Yeah, and they are really leaning into it. Like, it is a holiday themed MCU series. Like, it's not just like window dressing.
Like, no, it's actually like 4 days till Christmas, New yeah. York. Like, it's yeah, it's
and I think that's also going to play a part in the storyline where, like, you know, where all this is happening, and it's like, you know, I'll be home for Christmas. Like, I'm sure that song will be cute at some point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably where it'll end, right? But yeah. Yeah, I'm really intrigued. I'm in the same boat where I don't know if I necessarily loved it. I love Hailee Steinfeld as Kate Bishop. I don't know if I loved the first two episodes, but I am intrigued to see where it goes. So I hope you guys enjoy it out on Wednesday, which would be tomorrow if you're listening to this right away, or maybe you've already watched those first two episodes, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on the opening and Rogers the Musical and different things like that. So hit us up. If you like this, we have other reviews that we would love for you guys to check out right here on Untitled Movie Reviews. You can check out our review for Tick, Tick, Boom, as well as what else do we have, Eric?
We have Encanto coming up. We have House of Gucci.
House of Gucci.
We have There's Resident Evil. Welcome to Raccoon City. Yeah, King Richard.
King Richard was the one that I was thinking of. And Ghostbusters Afterlife, which I think was a great conversation between Eric and I. So go check that out. That came out this past weekend as well.
And we'll probably also have reviews coming up for things like Benedetta and
lots of stuff coming up. It's a busy time. It's a busy time. Yeah. The screeners are piling up, but I'm excited. Thank you all for listening. Please go check us out on YouTube. If you listen to the audio version, we would love that. Just search Untitled Movie Podcast. We'll probably pop up. And if you watch the video version, go subscribe to our podcast feeds, which are Untitled Movie Podcast, Untitled Movie Reviews, and Untitled Movie Conversations. A one-stop shop for everything, always over on Letterboxd, Untitled_Movies. Links to all of those shows, as well as our star ratings and different things like that. So go check that out. As always, my name is Matt Rohrbeck. You can find more of my work around the internet, but mostly at untitledmoviepodcast.com. And you can follow me on all the social medias at Matt Rohrbeck.
And I'm Eric Marchand. You can find more of my video reviews at rogerstv.com/cinemascene and on the social medias at EM6211.
Until next time.
Bro, I'm going to open that Jeremy Renner app right now.
Bro.